آله وأصحابه ومن سلك مسلكه to have been converged here today. We beseech Allah's blessing upon the noblest of mankind, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We've taken ourselves through some some portion of the Quran, the tafsir of some verses of one of the big chapters in the Holy Quran. The chapter is Surah Al-Fatih, Surah to Fatiri. Messages, the teachings, the etiquettes of Islam that revolve around those 10 verses from Surah Al-Fatih. We beseech Allah, we pray to Him to accept what we shall do here to the act of Ibadah and make it a worthy of our being accepted from us all, those that are going to listen to what we shall be saying, and we ourselves that shall be saying, taking us through, steering us through the Dawah explanation. We are in a world where it isn't strange any longer for a Muslim that is conscious of the events around him or her to understand and notice that the ways and manners in which we live life are in most cases at a contradistinction to the fundamental teachings and messages that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam epitomizes. In a society where Muslims, I would say, are not courageous enough to identify with many of the essentials, many of the fundamentals of this religion. Not that courageous. It is not because Islam is not given the required space in our society. The fact that we feel not courageous to identify with Islam is owing to our fault. Our fault in the sense that we do not get ourselves equipped with what Islam requires of us. Islam requires that our being Muslims should go beyond the four corners of the mosque. Our being believers should not be limited within the confines of what we are told, within the confines of what that with which we are sermonized in all the perfect Islam demands from us. But I wouldn't say to our astonishment, I would say, as a result of the fact that what we are to have gone through, what we are to have gone through in having updated what we claim to know, what we claim to have known rather, with respect to these fundamentals of our religion, our fault in having not been able to respond and identify as it were with these essentials of our religion has been the major stumbling block against one, utmost understanding of the religion, two, our incapacity to convince others of that which Islam is laden with. This is our fault. If we look at our society, we are going to be confronted with the starking reality that in most cases, most of the crimes, because we are not going to shy away from telling one another what the truth is. Most of the crimes, especially in the recent times, that are committed, are mostly committed by people who are Muslims by names. People who nominally identify with Islam, but who are never deep-seated in the teachings, who are never deep-seated in understanding, in internalizing the essentials and basics of what Islam teaches. So that has been the reality that you and I have often lived with, and that is why some scholars do say that you and I in the contemporary times go through what we call identity crisis. You see people portraying Islam. You see people being clad in the Islamic regalia, but when you corner them, or when they are cornered, you will see that what they showcase does not come to terms with what Islam demands from you and me. That is identity crisis. When to be the ideology that you profess does not come to terms with what your religion teaches, that is identity crisis. And that has been another part of the challenges we go through. And in order to come over these challenges, in order to assess especially the fringe ones among us, there are a number of fringe ones among us, those who get involved in a number of dastardly acts, all in the name of wanting to defend Islam, all in the name of wanting to make themselves part and parcel of the Muslim Ummah. They don't want to be seen as the non-conformist. They go around with Islamic names. They go around with Islamic identities. But in actual fact, in actual sense, what they do puts Islam to a challenge. What they do, what they showcase, relegates Islam to a challenge. In order to bring those people as well from the quagmire of moral and ideological bankruptcy into which they've immersed themselves, we have to stage a lecture of this pedigree. And that is why we felt that going through the Quran, journeying into what the Quran teaches sometimes, will salvage us from the social woes into which we have plunged ourselves. So that is the synopsis of why we are gathered here today. And to begin, I will say that Islam as a religion can never be understood except that the person claiming to understand Islam goes through the Quran. If what you claim to understand, with what you profess to understand about Islam, is not in conformity, is not in tandem with the teachings of the Quran, because that was what the companions of Muhammad understood and gave them the effrontery to take Islam as far as Europe. They understood that. They understood the tenets of the Quran as explained and broken down by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If what you claim to understand, if what you profess as an understanding of Islam is not in conformity with the teachings and tenets of the Quran, you are not a complete Muslim. So, going through that, we'll equally say that tafsir, finding meanings for some of the verses of the Quran, does not say that we are giving you the meanings from the horse's mouth. We're only trying to bring you closer to that your religion preaches, which will form part and parcel of your understanding, part and parcel of the practical way in which you should live life. Allah in the 29th verse of Surah Fatir, that 29th verse, verse 29, Allah is intimating you and me, because we must be frank with one another, that you observe Salah on daily basis, that you might have performed Hajj, that you give Zakah on a yearly basis, and that you fast during every month of Ramadan, does not give you an absolute license to claim that you've understood Islam in totality. There are a number of aspects. Truly, people say that there are five pillars of Islam. But we say that to the beginners. We explain that to the beginners. But as you advance further in identifying with Islam, you discover that there are 1,000 other aspects. There are 1,000 other pillars that Islam is fortified with. Allah says in the 29th verse that, because I should be conscious of the time. Allah says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الذين يتلون كتاب الله وأقاموا الصلاة وأنفقوا مما رزقناهم سرا وعلانية يرجون تجارة لن تبور. Allah says, إن الذين يتلون كتاب الله, from the verse, Allah makes it known categorically that those who, from time to time, those who continually, those who from every minute, from every second, recite the book of Allah, in al-ladina yatluna kitab Allah, they will never relegate reciting the Quran to Ramadan alone. They will reciting the Quran to when they run into troubles. Allah says, those who continually recite the Quran, yatluna kitab Allah, those who understand through their continual perusal of the Quran, through their continual recitation of the Quran, those who do this, if you are deep rooted in the recitation of the Quran, you will take your salah serious. الَّذِينَ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ, those who recite continually the book of Allah, وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ, and observe salah, وَأَنْفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقُنَاهُمْ, and spend part of what we have out them with. Allah says, those people, يَرُجُونَ تِجَارَةً لَنْ تَبُورَ, are expecting to partner with Allah in a way that shall bring them eternal reward. They are expecting to get with Allah over a merchandise that shall condition them to eternal reward. So that is the first way to go. So you can't just be a complete Muslim. You can't just be a conscious Muslim without having a perpetual contact, a perpetual communion with the Quran. There's no way you can do that. And I must say this before we advance. Those who continually put Islam to challenges, those you know that continually put Islam to challenges, do not understand the Quran. Those who feel that each time they kill a soul, those who feel that each time they maim a human being of their pedigree, those who think that each time a church is detonated, those who feel that each time a Christian is gruesomely murdered, they defend Islam, do not understand the Quran. They don't understand the Quran. They do not share any known borders with Islam. In al-ladina yatluna kitab Allah, those who recite. So the first challenge here is going to all Muslims. If we say we recite the Quran, the next question is, do you understand what you recite? The fact that we recite the Quran but don't understand the verses, the meanings of the verses, the meanings of the chapters we recite, is giving non-Muslims that, you know, say over us. They say your Quran is replete with technicalities. And why would they say that? They will, because they know that you and I are in most cases ignorant of the teachings of the Quran. You read the Quran on daily basis, but the meanings of what you recite are not known to you. We've put this to test severally. We have put it to test severally. People will say the Quran says that a Muslim woman, a virtuous Muslim, should cover herself from head to toe. The women folk amongst us say this. But if you corner these people and make them tell you where the verse that actually teaches that a virtuous woman in Islam must cover herself from head to toe is in the Quran, 80 to 85% of those who say that, who chant that, do not know where the verse is in the Quran. And this convinces you and me that those who say the Quran is replete with technicalities, how they say, for crying out loud, how will I be reciting a book for over 3 decades, for over 5 decades, without having had a robust engagement, a linguistic engagement with that book. This is the first area where many of us as Muslims. Allah says he does not invite the ignoramer to Islam. That is what the Quran is saying here. The ignorant Muslims are not invited to Islam. We invite people who are knowledgeable, people who are motivated by the truer search, by the truer quest for knowledge. They are the ones invited to Islam. And without mincing our words, this is what the companions demonstrated when they got to Spain. So as we advance, we shall go historical as we advance. For you to know that it is our incapacity to have engaged intellectually the Quran that is making some people cast aspersions against our faith. They will say you don't know where this is said in the Quran, and in actual fact, we don't know. And we say we are Muslim, we say we are conscious. Where is that consciousness coming from? The consciousness that is not strengthened by your capacity to dissect the meanings of the Quran, and you claim you are conscious. You are not conscious. Allah says, "Inna alladhina yatluna kitaba Allah." You can't be reciting the Quran without having understood its meanings. You can't be reciting the Quran on a daily basis without you, I'm thinking of a way to engage linguistically, to engage intellectually with the Quran. And how do you do that? You are going to engage with the Quran intellectually by you being able to break down the verses with respect to what they mean. That is how we can have a practical Islam. The Islam you and I practice in most cases is a hereditary Islam. Because my father is an Alhaji. That is what we go around chanting. My mother is an Alhaja. That is what we go around chanting. It is not because I've got convinced that Islam is my religion. And you can't get convinced that a particular religion should be your way of life without you having been able to understand, having been able to reconstruct the essentials and basics of that religion. So this is a way to tell us that the Quran is calling us to a challenge. In alladhina yatluna kitaba Allah wa aqamus salah. If you are perfect, if you are must succeed in having internalized the teachings, the basics, the essentials of Islam as dished out by the Quran, your salah will be perfect. Wa aqamus salah. In this part of the world where you and I find ourselves, there are people who observe solar, but whose solar does not conform with the descriptions of the Quran. And why doesn't their solar conform with the descriptions of the Quran? It is because they do not tailor what they claim to have understood in observance of that solar with what the Quran teaches as the etiquette of solar. It may sound surprising, but that is the reality about us. People have been going to Hajj for over 30 years, for over 50 years, for over 40 years. But the synopsis of what the Hajj should do in their lives is not manifest. Why? Because they go to Hajj for going sick. They go to Umrah for going sick. They have not deemed it fit. They have not for once deemed it fit to cool their understanding with respect to going to Hajj and Umrah from where? From the Quran. In alladhina yatluna kitaba Allah wa aqamu salah wa anfaqu mimma razaqnahum. Those who spend a portion from that with which they've been endowed. Allah says, yaruduna tijaratan lan tabura, are expecting a partnership with Allah that shall confer on them eternal reward. This is what the companions of Muhammad SAW succeeded in doing. They went out of this world with eternal rewards. They went out of this world with eternal rewards, which became manifest while they were in the service of the earth, and which still remain and shall remain till eternity after their demise. They made themselves an epitome of the Quran that works everywhere, and they were able to succeed. And that is what we expect from us contemporary Muslims. Allah continues saying that. Allah says, those who spend what we have bestowed them with, sirran in their closet, sirran in their privacy, wa alaniyatan, and in public. Sirran in their closet, sirran in their privacy, wa alaniyatan, in public. Allah says, they are the ones expecting, they are the ones awaiting my eternal. So if you go through that, you know, by way of breaking it down, we have a number of questions to put across, and for which we know we don't have answers. Why, if we say we spend, why do we spend? If we say we float charities, why do we float charities? Do we spend, do we float charities just because to get our last eternal reward? Or do we do so in order to gain people's popularity? This is a question. Like I said earlier, question and several other ones are here for which you and I have no answers. Allah says, I've tailored the possibility, the certainty of your act of worship being accepted or being acceptable around your understanding of the Quran. I've tailored the acceptance of your act of worship around your understanding of the Quran. Why do I do so? Allah says, لِيُوَفِيَهُمْ أُجُورَهُمْ وَيَزِيدَهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Allah says, I do so in order that you are going to get your reward in the fullest or to the fullest. وَيَزِيدَهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ, and that I will increase you in manifold. Allah says, Innahu ghafurun shakurun. Allah says, Innahu ghafurun is the oft forgiving. Shakurun is the appreciative. Whatever you do, Allah appreciates it. Going by these two verses alone, you and I must have got convinced that we've not begun. We're only in the ingrams into understanding what Islam teaches. Our Islam, that, like I said earlier, our Islam that is not fortified by the true teachings of the Quran, what kind of Islam is that? Is that what the Prophet ﷺ preached to the people of Mecca? Is the kind of Islam you and I practicing today, are practicing today rather, the same thing that the Prophet ﷺ preached to the people of Medina? One of the scholars of Islam, when he was trying to describe whom the companions were right before Muhammad ﷺ and after his departure, he says, "As-sahaba kanu al-Qur'an alladhi yamshi al-ardi." The companions were like the Quran right before Muhammad said that was walking around on the surface of the earth. That was whom they were. That was whom they were. And who are we today? Who are we today? Do you know why the companions succeeded in this regard? It was because they invested all they had into understanding the Quran, into receiving the Quran unconditionally. They succeeded. Allah continues saying, Allah says, "Walladhi awhayna ilayka," for those who do not know, I will still go into the details. Allah says, what we have inspired, what we have referred unto you, Muhammad, min al-kitabi, as a book, huwa al-haqq, is nothing but the truth. The Quran, this Quran that we have referred unto you, Muhammad, is nothing but the truth. Musaddiqan lima bayna yadayhi, Allah says, it is true because the Quran continually establishes the symphony that subsists between it and the other scriptures that Allah had referred before its revelation. The Quran is nothing but the truth because it unravels, it x-rays the symphony that the books, the scriptures that Allah had referred before it held. Allah says, in Allah bi'ibadihi lakhabirun basirun. Allah says, I say this because I know that what you shall be doing, what you shall be professing, wouldn't be beyond my knowledge. Because in Allah bi'ibadihi lakhabirun basirun. Allah says, I see you and I know for sure what you do. I know for sure what you do. The Quran, like our creator says, is nothing but the truth because it certifies the fact that the other scriptures that had come before it were truly came from Allah, and that the contents of those other scriptures, the contents of those other scriptures before the Quran do not in any manner run at a contradistinction to what the Quran itself teaches. For those who don't know this, because that is another area where many of us contemporary Muslims have seemingly failed. When we don't invest our time in the Quran, how many of us deem it fit to get enrolled at the Arabic in those schools? We say it is over our dead bodies. And when a phenomenon is not useful for your living bodies, will that same phenomenon be useful to your dead bodies? When a phenomenon is not friendly to your living bodies, would that same phenomenon be useful to your dead bodies? We don't see it as something worthy of being actualized in life. When we see people enrolling in the Arabic schools, enrolling at centers where they shall be tutored what Quran is and what it contains, we consider them as the backward among us. Those who go to the Arabic schools among us are like the backward. They are like the myopic. They are like the short-sighted among us. That is our impression of those people. And meanwhile, those people whom we regard as the myopic, as the short-sighted among us, are the future fangers of this religion. Because one thing that distinguishes Islam from several other religions in this life is the fact that you can't be ignorant and claim to understand Islam. You can't be ignorant and claim to understand Islam. If you are trying to make yourself happy over the fact that you are ignorant about several other areas that Islam speaks about, you are going to get tired one day. You are going to get tired one day. I could remember the Quran, into which you and I don't want to invest any longer. The Quran, into which you and I don't want to invest in any longer, was the same book that salvaged the whole Europe. Before the medieval period, and I'm fairly sure this is a university environment. You know, you can't just come here and say what you like. Before the medieval period, and right into the medieval period, there wasn't a single European scholar that was as knowledgeable as the companions had been. There wasn't a single European scholar who was as knowledgeable as the companions of Muhammad had been. If I look for a proof for this from the Quran, you will say, and likewise several other people who are listening to us, that, you know, who will he defend if not the companions of this prophet? If I say I will bring a proof from the traditions of the prophet. Those who are listening to us will say that, who will he defend if not, you know, the traditions of his prophet? But the proofs that before the medieval, right inside the medieval period, there wasn't a single European scholar who was as knowledgeable as the companions had been. The proofs have come from the European historians themselves. What do they say about the Quran? What do they say about Islam? What do they say about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What do they say about the concept of divinity in Islam, from which you and I run today? Many of us today don't want to listen to the fact that the Quran is the truest book of God. Many of us don't feel comfortable being told that this system of knowledge you are acquiring today came from the prophet, from the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many of us don't feel comfortable being told that. One French scholar, Gustave Le Bon by name, you know, he's trying to show you, because it sometimes stands astonishing for non-Muslims to be telling you and me that Islam is beautiful. It is astonishing for non-Muslims, especially European scholars who in their heydays were never Muslims, to tell us that Islam is beautiful. It is astonishing, surprising, and should be, you know, in another way, should be humiliating to you and me. When what you don't know is being told by those who are not practicing your religion, it is humiliating. It is painful. Because you yourself deem it free to know what these people are saying. Very humiliating. Gustave Le Bon, that French historian, says that لَوْ لَمْ يَظْهَرِ الْعَرَبُ عَلَى مَصْرِهِ تَارِيخٍ. For the fact that is what he says, لَوْ لَمْ يَظْهَرِ الْعَرَبُ عَلَى مَصْرِهِ تَارِيخٍ. If not for the fact that the Arabs had emerged on the pages of history, لَتَأَخَّرَتْ نَهْضَةُ أُوروبَا تَلْحَدِي سَتَعِدَّةَ قُرُونٍ. The intellectual stardom, the material stardom around which Europe backs today could have been delayed for a number of centuries. These are non-Muslim writers. These are Western writers who are giving Islam a kind of appraisal that you and I don't give it. لَوْ لَمْ يَظْهَرِ الْعَرَبُ عَلَى مَصْرِهِ تَارِيخٍ. If the Arabs had not emerged, and what did the Arab of the era, what did they know? They knew the language of the Quran. What did the Arab of the era swallow? They swallowed the teachings of the Quran. With whom did the Arab of the era fraternize? They fraternized with the companionship of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If anyone says Muslims the world over today to troubles, we shouldn't ascribe the causes, the factors for such troubles onto someone else. We should look inward first before beginning to ascribe the causes of the troubles onto some other people. Another European scholar, but a contemporary scholar, Victor Robinson. When he was comparing the indices of growth, material and spiritual growth, between the Arab world and Europe in the medieval period. Victor Robinson says that for those who do not consider the Quran as the right recipe for understanding Islam amongst us, and I keep on saying among, because that is an aspect that concerns you and me. There are a number of homes today, a number of Muslim homes, where it has been made a taboo for the members of those homes to get enrolled in Arabic Institute. You will see mothers and fathers Muslim mothers and fathers telling their wives that should you join the MSSN on getting to the campus, I'm going to disown you. That is a first class madness. It is a first class madness for you to tell your wives in these contemporary times. We are troubles are closer to everybody's doorstep. For you to tell your wives, be they females, be they males, that should they join, for instance, the MSS and get into campuses, they're going to disown them. And you should be prepared. You should be prepared to welcome troubles with which they shall come home. Victor Robinson was comparing the indices of spiritual and material growth between the Islamic world and Europe in the medieval period. He says, وكان أطفال المسلمين وكان أشراف أوروبا أشراف أوروبا لا يستطيعون توقيع أسمائهم بينما كان أطفال المسلمين يذهبون إلى المدارس. He didn't write in Arabic. He wrote like his other companion, his other counterpart, Robert Bruford, who wrote The Making of Humanity, as said. Robinson says, Ashraf Uroba, European statesman, Kanu la yastati'una tawqi'a asma'ihim, were stuck illiterate before the Muslims got to Spain, before the Muslims got to Europe. The European statesmen and women were stuck illiterate. Bainama kana tufalu al-muslimina yadhabuna ila al-madaris, at a time when the children of the Muslims in Spain had already been attending Arabic schools. Look at that. He says, wa kana rubanu uroba. He says, the religious leaders, the church leaders, as they are called in history, the European church leaders, يلحنون في قراءة التوراة were unable to perfect their recitation of the Torah, the Old Testament. They don't know how to recite it. And where they claim to know, they did not perfect the recitation. بينما كان مسلم كرتبة, at a time when the Cordova Muslims, you know, Cordova was in Spain. Like Granada was in Spain. Those two areas were some of the strongholds of the Muslims in Spain and Europe. He says, Warubano Uroba, the church leaders in Europe, Yalhanuna Fikirati Asfari Taura, were unable to perfect the recitation of the book of God they claimed they had received. Bainama kana Muslim Kurutuba, at a time when the Muslims in Cordova had built a library, Fida Khomatiha, Tudoriu Maktabata Alexandria Tel Adima. At a time the Muslims in Cordova had built a big library that was as large as that was as commodious as the library of Alexander the Great in Egypt. What brought this success or these successes onto the companions? What? The Quran, into which you and I don't want to invest these days. That is where Allah begins this portion of Surah Fatirin with saying, Inna alladhina yatluna kitab Allah. The companions, before leaving for Baghdad, and before they sent their students in the they said nothing other than what? Other than the Quran. And it is that Quran that we are saying the non-Arab writers from among the Westerners are defending. That is for Victor Robinson. As for another European scholar, French scholar, when he was giving encomia, he was showering encomia on the Quran, he says, "Wakana He says, in al-Bashariya, he says, humanity in totality, la taftakhiru bintisabi rajulin ka Muhammadin ilayha. The humanity, la taftakhiru, should be proud of that a man of Muhammad's pedigree. The humanity in totality should be proud that they have identified with a man of Muhammad's pedigree. This is another encomium on what? On the sanctity one and on the symphony of the Quran and on the fact that it is nothing but the truth. But as these non-European, as these non-Arab scholars are saying, is what they are saying, what you and I believe with the Quran. That is why I said earlier that we live in what? In crisis. We live in identity crisis. We claim we are Muslims, but do not know what makes one a true Muslim. We claim we are knowledgeable. This is you and I are seated here today. You and I have this community, for instance, we are claiming we've been here to acquire our knowledge. The companions had never attended a university known other than what? Other than the university. She had, are you following, constructed and directed by what? By Muhammad, that unlettered prophet. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The companions had never attended the university. Neither are they attended Harvard University. Neither are they attended Oxford or Cambridge University. They didn't attend UI. Neither did they attend Unilony. Neither did they attend Leeds City University. They got schooled through what? Through that so inspiring, so edifying religious center, intellectual center built and supervised and managed by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that on later the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at you and I are here. What you claim to know is not following the tenets of Islam. Allah says, Thumma arasna al-kitaba, the book with which the companions had lived lives, the book, the Quran, with which Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had reinvigorated the vitality of all and sundry in this world. That same book, the Quran, Allah says, we handed it down unto alladhina istafayna min ibadina, those who have chosen among our creatures. you are not. Allah says, I've handed down that book, the same book, the book Muhammad sallallahu used to reinvigorate the whole world, the same book that the companions, the one of Alim Ajma'in, used to liberate the people of Europe, the same they had taught the European statesmen, the European intelligentsia, what no other scholar had ever taught them. Allah says, we handed the book down to Alladhina istafayna min ibadina, you and me. Allah says, faminhum dhalimun waminhum muqtasidun waminhum sabiqun bil khayrati bi idhnillah. Allah says, as the book got handed down to them, they split into three. Minhum dhalim, there are among us who are perpetual transgressors. Faminhum dhalim nafsi, who are perpetual transgressors, who are perpetual wrongdoers, who do not portray Islam. Who do not portray Islam the way it should be portrayed? Those who misrepresent Islam amongst us. فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ. Allah says, وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ, those who are murdered. وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, those who are ever trailblazers. These are the three categories into which we have all split. And that signals to the team part of which today's lecture is, that is benignance, showing mercy.
And out of whom should we show mercy unto those who misrepresent Islam among us? They are the al-dhalimun among us. Those who are on the campus, but are never comfortable to identify themselves with this house. Neither are they comfortable with identifying with their meal. Neither are they comfortable identifying with them with the Amira. And neither are they comfortable identifying themselves with all the teachings, tenets, and fundamentals of Islam. They are those ones who perpetually club. They will club, they will groove. In fact, there are some of them who do not remove the hijab on their heads. There are some of them who are heavily bearded than you are. And you see them at disco club. You see them at nightclubs. And if you say, what is your name? They will tell you one of the beautiful names in Islam. They will say they are Muhammad. They will say they are Ismail. They will say they are Ishaq. And those ones, that is where Allah is pointing to. Allah says, فَمِنُهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمِنُهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ وَمِنُهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ ذَلِكَ وَالْفَضْلُ الْكَبِيرُ. Allah says, these are the two categories. And that you have found yourself in the category in which you are is a blessing from Allah. That you don't fornicate as those transgressors do is a blessing. That you don't womanize as those transgressors do is a blessing. That right under your khimar, right under your hijab, you don't engage in fornication, it's a blessing. But your beard, as heavy as you see, as it is, as heavy as it appears, you don't defraud people all under the disguise of Yahweh, it's a blessing. Allah says, this first category, the category of the moderate, and the category of the trailblazer. Allah says, you are all my servants. So that is the message. Don't excommunicate. Don't condemn people to eternal doom. Don't say you shall enter hell. I'm very sure what I'm saying, that you should not excommunicate, that you should not condemn people to eternal doom, will never go down with the noisemakers among us. They never find it comfortable. But that is never our palaver. Our palaver is, like Muhammad SAW did in Makkah and Medina, how do we take that guy who is incurably alcoholic out of where he goes to? How do we take that sister? How do we take that sister and bar her forever from parading herself, from striping naked at the Echo Groove? How do we assist that Muslim brother who defrauds under the disguise of partnering with the white man he doesn't see? How do we take him away from that spiritual and intellectual quagmire? Allah says, you are all my servant. The Prophet ﷺ, I want to break this down here. When Allah compartmentalizes us into three, when Allah categorizes us into three, saying, فَمِنُهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمِنُهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ وَمِنُهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ. After this categorization, the Prophet ﷺ went hell-bent, or I would say goes hell-bent, telling you and me that, and the transgressors among us, the moderate, and the trailblazers, he says, Allah tells him that we are all dwellers of Al-Jannah. So why then do you want to die? Just because some Muslims are committing crimes. You shouldn't, I don't know why I should relish. I don't know why I should marvel and take delight in the fact that some of my brethren are engaging in what will bring Allah's wrath till eternity on them. And I don't feel like correcting them. I don't know why I should relish in that. Truly, the sister has not been using the hijab. That does not mean we should excommunicate her. We should stop practicing madness and idiocy. We shouldn't forget. You see, there are some people among us who only remember verses that condemn Muslims. Who only look for verses in the Quran and a number of traditions of the Prophet that excommunicate Muslims. They don't see the other verses. Allah says, كَذَلِكَ كُنْتُمْ مِنْ قَبِلُوا فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ. They are among the holier than you sisters today. The holier than you sisters today. Who have once fornicated. They are among the holier than you brothers today. Who have once defrauded people. They are among the holier than you brothers and sisters today. Who have once tasted alcohol. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has never exposed your stinky anuses, you should stop exposing the anuses of other Muslims. The Prophet ﷺ says, and if you want to die, you may die. He says, Wa'ulahi, these three categories, bimanzilat and wahida, they are the same before Allah. These three categories, faminuhum zalimun li nafsihi, wa minhum muqtasidun, wa minhum sabiqun bil khayrati bi idhnillah. Allah says, and the Prophet says, kamanzilatin wahida. They are in the same stratum before Allah. They belong to the same category before Allah. And He says, wa kulluhum fil jannah. And they're going to enter paradise. وَكُلُّهُمْ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. So it only behoves on you and me to work effortlessly to assist these people. Sometimes what we tell them, and we must be factual with one another, what we tell those categories of people rather, pisses them off. What we tell them pisses them off. There was a tradition of the Prophet. I've gone into details of the verses. The Prophet ﷺ was seated with the companions. He was teaching them a number of other fundamentals of Islam. All of a sudden, a man came from an unknown corner and said, O Prophet, inni laqitu mura'atan. I want us to be attentive here. I want us to be attentive and, you know, I must be sincere with the way we preach Islam, especially to those ones upon whom we look. The guy may be smoking today. He may cease from smoking tomorrow. And once he ceases smoking, he may be better than you are before Allah. We all know that Umar was once a kafir, and when he reverted to Islam, he was better than several other Muslims. He was better than several other companions, up to a point when the Prophet ﷺ certified Umar. He gave him that sanctity. He says that لَقَدْ كَانَ مِمَّنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ قَوْمٌ مُحَدَّثُونَ. He says there are people before you, elements who are being spoken to. لَقَدْ كَانَ مِمَّنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ قَوْمٌ مُحَدَّثُونَ. There have been before you people who have been spoken to. Who would receive, who would hear? Who would hear what Allah would instruct them through the Archangel Jibril? Who would hear like this? And he says, وَلَوْ كَانَ fi hadhihi aw min hadhihi al umma, and if there would be anyone in this umma of mine, lakana umar, the person shall be umar, and these umar are the ones, are you following, are the ones worshipped idol.
Umar are the ones persecuted the Muslims when they were in Mecca. Umar are the ones been averse. He had once been averse to all the teachings and messages of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam before he converted into Islam. And when he became a Muslim, he was a better Muslim. In fact, he was the best. He says, "Wa in kana fi hadhihi al-umma la kana Umar." The person will be no other person other than Umar. That guy says, "Oh, you prophet, inni laqitu mura'atan." This is an hadith reported by Al-Imam Muhammadu fi musnadihi. "Laqitu mura'atan, I came into contact." I want us to be attentive here, especially because what I'm saying now is just in a part of what I ought to say in this regard. We talk of those who continually discomfit those other Muslims whose level of iman is not up to us, but who are willing to be good Muslims, to be better Muslims. But it's only that what we say, what we tell them, pisses them off. This is their portion. And we shall also speak of those other Muslims. You see, there is this thing in Islam. There are things in this religion which, if not upheld in the right manner, we first should know where. There are things in this religion. There are aspects of Islam which, if not upheld in the right manner, we first should know where. You can't pray to Allah and expect that prayer will be accepted in nudity. You can't observe Salah. You can't observe Salah and expect that Salah shall be accepted by Allah in nudity. If that is what you've sketched for yourself, to go out naked, that is between you and yourself. And between you and yourself, if it is the time for prayer, when it is time for prayer, look for what will make your prayer complete. That you go around naked is never our edict. It's not our edict, and it is not going to discomfort us. But when you enter into this house of Allah, wanting to pray, wanting to observe Salah, you can't observe Salah in that nudity. In that nakedness, Allah wouldn't just accept it. So if we tell you this, telling you this shouldn't make you mad. We are telling you what is factual. But as regards what you do, other things, you know, are you engaged in, we must be careful about our choice of words, about the registers with which we want to express that before you. The guy says, "Oh, you prophet, like you tomorrow at 10, I met a lady fi bustanin, in a garden, fa ajabani ma yujibu rijala fi nisa." And what does attract men in women attracted me. "Fa lazaqtu biha," and I couldn't control my emotions. I moved closer to her. "Lazikutu biha ogha illa anni lamu jamia," except that I did not have any kind of knowledge with her. The guy told Muhammad Sassan this, expecting that the Prophet Sassan will condemn him, will excommunicate him. When he narrated this, the Prophet Sassan, in the first place, was speechless. He was just staring at the guy as you are staring at me. He was looking. And the moment the guy narrated his ordeal in that garden, Umar said, "Hey, laqad satarahu Allahu law satara nafsahu," and Allah had covered him up. If only he had covered himself up, because Umar thought that the Prophet would say, "Go and eliminate him." And the guy turned back, going. The Prophet says, "Rudu alayya," bring that boy to me. bring that bottle. He had listened to the narration. He says, Laki tomorrow aitan, fibu standing, fa ajabani, ma yujibu rijala fin nisa, fa lazeqtu lam ujami'a. He had put that clause there. Illa anni lam ujami'a. He didn't fornicate. But he got overwhelmed. He got overwhelmed by what he had seen. The Quran says, a verse in Surah Al-Hud, Akimi Solata, Torofayi Nahari, Wazulafa Minal Layli, Innal Hasanati, Yudhibina Sayyat. It was on that day that that verse was refilled. The Quran recited that verse as it was being refilled. Hakimi Sola. And mind you, what I'm saying, I'm not giving any mortal the license. I'm not giving any lady here or those listening to us any license to be hugging men. If you do so, you do so at your own peril. If you do so thinking that nobody sees you, Allah will make nemesis to catch up with you. Neither have I given any man, whether he's listening to us now or is seated here, the license to be involving in what Allah would never be pleased with him over. I don't give anybody. I'm trying to bring senses back onto ourselves by making us relearn Islam. We have to unlearn what we claim we've known in order to relearn Islam. We can't make people better Muslims if we continue condemning, if we continue excommunicating these people. The Prophet Hassan says that you should be reciting this verse and you should be observing I'm a salah, tahajud every night. And the guy asks, do you mean this verse is for me alone? I'm linnasi kafa. Is it for me alone over my predicament? Or is it is meant for all and sundry who could have also found themselves in that in which I have found myself? The Prophet says, Al-Aya, Laka, Walinasi Kafa. The verse is for you and for every other mortal who could have found him or herself in what you found yourself. So the bottom line of what I'm emphasizing is that don't say the sister is moving around with pairs of trousers. We all know, even without being told, that it is un-Islamic. We all know. We all know that every form of prayer we could have observed with a pair of trousers alone, without a wrapper, without a khimar, we know that in the form of prayer is not going to be accepted by Allah. We know. And the person trying to tell you also believes that you should have understood that. But it is only that the mannerisms with which he tells you are faulty. So we shouldn't condemn. We shouldn't excommunicate. The sister you could have met at the entrance of Echo Groove, spot her face. Know her. Send people to her if you can't confront her yourself. He may not have been convinced of the enormity of what she is doing. And they only need to be spiritually reawakened. It isn't everybody that plies, for instance, Echo Groove, the bubbles, that is in Norma Beno. It isn't everyone. Neither is it everyone that steals money, that is in Norma Beno. Some people may be spiritually sick. Neither is it everyone that drinks is in Norma Beno. They may need to be talked to spiritually. But if your position is that once you know he dresses in that manner, once she dresses in that manner, she can never be a better Muslimah. That is in your own abstraction.
That is in your own impression. That is not what Islam teaches.
There were among the companions people who were drunkards before the verse that prohibits drinking was referred. They were drunkards. They would drink and still come and still have the effrontery to come to the mosque and pray. They would drink. There was a time Usman ibn Affan got inebriated. He drank to stupor. And he led in prayer. He led in Fajr prayer. Instead of him to observe two rak'ah, he observed how many? Four. The Prophet did not say, you these people have been earmarked for hell. He didn't say that. So that is why the Prophet, like I said, says, Wahaulahi, for those of us who claim we are the Madrid, and for those who are the trailblazers, no trailblazers exist elsewhere other than the companions. They have gone. The prophets of Allah, the companions are the trailblazers. For those of us who claim that we are the Madrid, we should be careful. We shouldn't force people on through what we see, through what we preach, through the mannerisms of how we want to get them corrected. We should not. And for us here, this is a university environment. You may have been fortunate to have come from a religious home. You don't know where I have come from. You may never tell. Probably my father is a masquerade. You may not tell. Then how could you tell whether my mother, are you following? Whether my mother does not cover herself up. You may not tell. And for me to have come from those homes, from homes in this pedigree, should have told you a lot about me. So you find me in the university with whom I've presented myself to be. You don't condemn me. Don't condemn me. And for those for whom we've been saying this, we don't condemn. We only want to straighten you, that you do what you do, that you do not get it. It's an eyesore to Islam. You are an eyesore. Just figure this out yourself. A Muslim by name, whether you are Nora, whether you are Zaina, whether you are Nafisa, we don't know. But that Muslim by name, with your hijab, even without your hijab, with your Islamic name, you are caught red-handed, having fun with one of your lecturers, for instance, or you are caught red-handed, having fun with one of your classmates. Are you portraying Islam in a light manner? And you see, people with whom we live in this world don't want to know whether you are an Eleha or not. They will say, one Muslim lady. They will say, in fact, those Alajas are also very facile. They are vibrant. Just because they've seen you in that dastardly act. So you've constituted in one way or the other an eyesore to those other innocent Muslims around. And for that, for the fact that you've misrepresented them, Allah may be annoyed with you. And don't say, they say Allah will punish you. Truly, you've been fornicating for long. Allah does not just come to descend on a sinful creature in a day. What Allah says is that, Allah says, those who say, what does Allah want to do? How do people say this? They say this through what they engage in. They say this through what they involve themselves in. You drink, and they tell you, Allah doesn't like drinking. You say, what does Allah want to do? You fornicate. You cheat in the exams.
Truly, you've covered your face, but you are a devil incarnate under the niqab. And they say, oh, you Muslim, fear Allah. And you say, what does Allah want to do? Allah says, wala nudhiqanna alladhina kafaru min al-adhabi al-adina min al-adhabi al-akbar la'allahum yarji'un. Allah says, we don't just descend on the sinful ones all of a sudden. Allah says, we make the sinful ones taste our punishment little by little in a piecemeal form. And you must have sensed that in your life. You must have sensed that in your life. No one will deface Islam and go scot-free. No scholar, no Muslimah will deface Islam and go scot-free. Allah's punishment, the fact that Allah is not pleased with you, is manifest in your life. It's only that you don't realize. It's only that you don't realize. Allah says, the transgressors, the wrongdoers, the murderers, and the trailblazers. Allah says, you are all my servants. Allah says, I'm going to decree that al-Jannah, Jannat Adin, I shall make you enter gardens of Eden. Yadkhulunaha, you shall enter those paradise. You shall enter those gardens. You shall have no fear in Asawiro, where you shall be festooned with gorgeous regalia. Clothes, the type of which you've never seen in this world. You shall have no fear in Asawiro. Min Asawiro min Dha'abin wa Luluha. Clothes, regalia that are laden with gold. Regalia that are laden with alulu, stones of ornament. Allah says, you shall be decorated with those regalia. To whom does Allah speak here? To the three categories of us all. The transgressors, if they repent before Nemesis, cash it off with them. The murderers, if they don't falter. And the trailblazers who have gone. Allah says, we shall all be entitled to an entry into the paradise. So whoever wants to die should die over that. If Allah says, there was a tradition of the prophet, because we must emphasize this. This evening, the gathering this evening is like a way to strike a reunion between us who claim we are the moderate, and between those upon whom we look, those who consider the irresponsible among us, those who think we never have an access to eternal beliefs. We want to reunite. And how do we reunite? We are going to reunite on the basis of a common understanding of Islam. That is why we began from the Quran. What the Quran is, what it is not, what the Quran teaches, what it does not teach, how the Quran has remade the companions into living epitomes of the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was where we began. We went into the encomia that the Western writers, non-Muslim scholars, have showered on Islam, on the Prophet, on the Quran, and on those, the companions, the predecessors who had lived before you and me. So we're now into how we can strike a reunion. How do we strike a reunion? We must have the same common understanding, the same understanding of the Quran. That is why I emphasize that we will do ourselves a great disservice. We will do ourselves a great disservice if we do not, I'm trying to patch the moral, spiritual, and intellectual loopholes in the ways we live life.
for the transgressors, the moral, intellectual, and spiritual loopholes in your lives must be patched, must be mended. And for the moderate, where we do transgress, where we do go beyond our boundaries in wanting to get others corrected, must also be corrected. Allah says, because we are all entitled to paradise, and there's nothing anyone can do about that. They are our companions who are the ones killed, who had killed their Muslim counterparts when these companions were non-Muslims. It was someone who killed Hamza. He later reverted into Islam. And willy-nilly, the Prophet would have to put up with that person. And the person who entered Al-Jannah. Because that was all he knew when he killed Hamza. He knew nothing else other than what he did. And thereafter, he became a Muslim. A better one. Who even assisted the cause of what? Of the jihad. In one of its most trying moments. So this is like a reunion. And for those, the transgressors among us, anytime you see us, don't run away from us. You say, I don't want that afar to see me. Let us see you. None of us here has come down to this university to study Arabic and Islamic studies. The afar, that afar from whom you are running, is also studying your course. Is a medical student like you are. That afa, that amira from whom you are running, studies what you are studying. She's studying pharmacy. The only area in which he is superior a bit than you are is because she understands it more than you do. And you give her the credit for that. Don't run from people. And you should be vigilant, conscious. You should be vigilant, conscious, and you should have the fear of Allah at heart. Whenever you are to get involved in what we defame Islam, fear Allah. No scripture, because we know what you do on campuses. No scripture, whether the Injil, whether the Torah, in their contemporary forms. And even the Quran, no scripture licenses you to be fornicating. No scripture licenses you to be moving around nakedly. No scripture. Whether the Bible, whether the New Testament, the Old Testament, even the Quran, no scripture licenses you to be moving around nakedly. So if you know that Amira, from whom you run, tells you that she's not being crazy. She's reminding you of what she feels you've forgotten. If that Amir, from whom you are running, tells you that, he's not being mad. And he's not being fanatical like you say. He's only trying to give you a helping hand. He wants to straighten your path so that Allah in the long run will be pleased with you. So that is what he's doing. Don't run, because you yourself know that what you do is not Islamic. You know. Will anyone tell us here? Will anyone who smokes hemp tell us here that he has seen a verse in the Quran that licenses smoking hemp? Nobody will say that. So if people tell you that don't smoke, smoking hemp. If people tell you that drinking. What do they drink now? They drink a lot. They drink Aloma. They drink Origina. They drink Erujeje. They drink Karaule. They drink Bebeku. All those filthy substances that you consume. You can never see a sane scholar, a sane Islamic scholar, who will tell you that what you are doing is normal. So when people tell you. When people tell you that what you are doing is un-Islamic, don't just get mad. Don't just get mad, rather. They are trying to remind you of the loophole in your makeup.
So that's what they are doing. Allah says, and we are giving the assurance. Because some people have told you that you shall languish in hell. And that is why you also resign to your ugly fate that if I should languish in hell with the fact that I fornicate, I will continue fornicating. That is why you are saying what you are saying. Some people have told you that you shall languish in hell for drinking aroma. And that is why you have resigned to that ugly fate that you shall continue drinking aroma. And we are saying that the Prophet ﷺ is giving you, is reassuring you that you are a dweller of what? Of Al-Jannah. He says, bimanzilatin wahida. You are the same before Allah. You are equal. You, the transgressors, us, the considered moderate, and the trailblazers. Bimanzilatin wahida. We are the same before Allah. Wakuluhum fil jannah. And all of you shall enter paradise. So we are giving you the reassurance that Islam is expecting you. Islam is expecting from you a positive U-turn. There is a tradition here for you to know that, like Allah says in a verse in the Quran, وَلَا تَزِرُوا وَعَزِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَ وَلَا تَزِرُوا وَعَزِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَ. No carrier of sin shall have the capacity to carry someone else's sin. لَا تَزِرُوا وَعَزِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَ. That you drink is not going to get me to a perpetual headache. Neither will it deprive me of what I'm entitled to as access into paradise. If you drink and you get condemned by Allah, if you drink and you get the doom from Allah, it is your palaver. But I'm obliged to remind you before the nemesis, you know, comes catching up with you. In a tradition, the Prophet ﷺ says that, in a tradition reported by Imam Ahmad, and that is what the last we shall say today, in a tradition reported by Imam Ahmad, Allah yarhamuhu, the Prophet ﷺ says that, Ad-dawawinu inda Allahi salasa. Ad-dawawinu inda Allahi salasa. My record, everyone else's record before Allah are just free. The file into which recorded before Allah. Your file into which all your deeds are recorded before Allah. And someone else's file into which is all our deeds are recorded before Allah are free. Allah says, the Prophet says, Diwanun la ya'bahu Allahu bihi shay'a. Allah says there is going to be a file out of these three files about which Allah will feel perturbed. Allah wouldn't feel bashed by the content of that file. That is one. Two, وَدِوَانٌ لَيَتْرُكُ اللَّهُ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا. There is going to be a file over which Allah will not be merciful with the owner. Over which Allah will not be Allah will not feel bashed. Another file over which Allah will not feel merciful with the owner. And the third one, Diwanun la yaghfiruhu Allahu, a file belonging to a creator, whom Allah will not forgive. This free. Now be ready to pick where your tent lies. The prayer says that, فَأَمَا الدِّوَانُ الَّذِي لَا يَغْفِرُهُ اللَّهُ. The prayer says, that file, the owner of which Allah will not forgive. Look at that. That file, the owner of which Allah will not forgive. The prayer says, فَشِرِكُ
is the defile of anyone who could have ascribed other gods, other effigies, other demigods unto Allah. Whoever could have found one thing, whoever could have been found one thing rather, for ascribing other gods, other deities unto Allah. Someone who could have called other creature of his and savior, that fire, its owner, will never be forgiven by Allah. So for you, you know, I said we've been categorized into free by Allah. There are some of us who are transgressors. So if you want to choose, you know, a path for yourself, you will decide after listening to this. If you want to be a perpetual transgressor, with whom Allah may not be pleased, you choose that path for yourself. That is one. The prayer says that is why Allah says that in Allah la yaghfiru an yushraka bih. Allah does not forgive. Or I would say, Allah is not used to forgiving anyone who ascribes other gods, demigods unto him. The second file, the prayer says that وَأَمَدِّوَانُ الَّذِي لَا يَعْبَوُ بِهِ شَيْئًا. The file over which Allah will not feel bashed, over which Allah will not feel bothered, is the file that belongs to Al-Abdu الَّذِي ظَلَمَ نَفْسَهُ. He says فَظُلْمُ الْعَبْدِ نَفْسَهُ فِي مَا بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ. That is a file belonging to a creator of Allah who could have plunged himself, who could have subjected himself into wrongdoing. And the Prophet expatiates further. He says, "Min shau min yaumin." The person ought to have fasted for a day, like in the month of Ramadan, but he did not fast. Aw salatin, the person ought to have observed a particular salah, a unit of prayer, which he did not observe. That is between Allah and the creator. Whatever sin you commit, or whatever sins rather you commit, shall be between you and Allah. Sins that are considered sins within the vineyard of Allah. Sins that become sins just because you have not upheld what Allah has said you should have upheld. That is between you and Allah. And the third one, the Prophet says that on this second one, the second file, he says, "Find Allah yaghfiru dhalika wa yatajawazu in sha'a." Allah may forgive that, and he may overlook that if he so wishes. And the third file, at the one already la yatruku law min shay'a, the file, the owner of which Allah will not forgive. Please, let's be attentive. The file, the owner of which Allah will not forgive. Who was that file? The prayer says that فَظُلُمُ الْعِبَادِ بَعْدِهِمْ بَعْدًا. If I sin against Allah, but my sinning against Allah has him in connection. My sinning, or my having sinned against Allah, is connected with him. Probably I've defrauded him. I have arrogated wrongly unto myself what belongs to him. Before Allah forgives me, before Allah will forgive me, he must have shown me forgiveness. He must have announced to me that he has forgiven and forgotten me. If he does not do that, I'm not going to be forgiven by Allah. So look at these three files. Consider their owners alone. Why do we condemn ourselves then? Why do we condemn one another? What I'm doing now, you may do what is better tomorrow. Because we could remember when we were learning, when we were in the Arabic school, we were looking up to some people ahead of us. They were the trailblazers. They knew what we had not known then. And today, that, you know, a Muslim, you know, still remains up to this point in time, does not mean he may not be better than Aham tomorrow.
That guy who is still in Odia dancing, singing, drumming may be holier than I am today. So why then do we still go hell-bent, condemning one another? It all boils down to the fact that we have not understood what the Quran. We are Allah started. Inna alladhina yatluna kitab Allah. If you want to condemn people, if you hold on to a verse of the Quran to do the condemnation, before you finish reciting, before you finish taking up for the meaning of that verse, you must have come across another verse that says don't condemn them. Inna alladhina yatluna kitab Allah. Those who continually, we shouldn't be Ramadanic Muslims. You know, there are Ramadanic Muslims among us. It is only in the month of Ramadan that they recite the Quran. But Allah says, those yatluna kitaballahi, those who continually, perpetually, whether there is Ramadan or not, whether Ramadan is around the corner or not, they will recite the Quran. Allah says, those people who do themselves a greater service. And what is that great? That they will understand. They will see beyond what an ordinary Muslim sees. This is where we have gone. So we are now, I'm putting it to us all, on the tone of finality, that we should stop all these nonsense that we do on campuses. When you are here, you might have been a member of the Ansaruddin before leaving your home. Once you are in the campus, don't come here wanting to stage the tent of Ansaruddin. You are here as a member of the MSSN. You may have been a member of the TMC before leaving your home. Don't come here wanting to strike out nonsensicality or madness, wanting to stage a tent for the TMC. Come under that single umbrella. You may be an Ahmadis in your home. That is your palaver. That is your palaver. You may be a Sufis in your home. That is your palaver. It is your pretty kettle of tea on getting here. Don't come here to stage a mayhem. Don't come here to dislodge what the sincere ones among us here have built. You may be a member of the OTM in your home. That is your palaver. Don't say you wouldn't listen to anyone except he, you know, is the person that manages your jilisa. That is madness. You come here in order that there will be no other flag under which all the Muslims will consider themselves as one other than what the flag hoisted by the MSSA. The Prophet says that Man salla salatana, you should know that whoever amongst us Muslims, whoever observes salah, prays salatana in the same ways and manners in which we also pray, wastaqbala qiblatana, and faces the same direction into which we face while praying, wa akala dhabihatana, and eat from whatever we could have slaughtered. He says, fa huwa al-muslimu, that is the Muslim. Falahu malana, whatever we are entitled to, he or she shall be equally entitled to it. Wa alayhi ma alayna, and whatever could have been considered as sin for against us, if he or she does that, it shall be considered a sin against him or her. أقول ما تسمعون أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو التواب الرحيم سبحان ربك رب العزة ما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.